everybody. Great to see you. If you got a Bible with you, let me hear your pages turning to the Gospel of Matthew and the sixth chapter. The Gospel of Matthew, the sixth chapter. When you find that, just hold that ready. Boy, what a beautiful weekend the Lord gave us. Somebody say amen to that. Except for Friday. I mean, I was so grouchy Friday. I didn't know if my wife was going to kick me out of the house or not. But on Friday, I was like, hey, forget about May or June 29th and 30th. I'm done. I'm turning my keys in. I'm out of here. I hate this weather. But then the Lord did what he does, and he gave us a beautiful couple of days, and we're so thankful for that. This is the first of a two-part message series on anxiety that's called Triggered. Now, that word triggered is a slang word that can be used in a few different contexts and a few different settings. The most common usage would be experiencing something in your life that causes you to recall some traumatic experience of your past in a way that really makes an impact on you. But over the years, that word has evolved a little bit to where it really just refers now to something that simply affects your mental state or your emotional state, oftentimes significantly, by causing you extreme emotional distress. And if there's one area of life where many, many people experience this reality, it is in the area of anxiety, worry and anxiety, because we live in an unprecedented age of anxiety. This last week, I spent a lot of time just reading different articles and looking at different surveys related to anxiety in our nation and in our culture, specifically broken down by generations. From what's called the Gen Z generation all the way up to baby boomers. I know we've got folks in our church that are a little older than that still, but I stopped at baby boomers. Gen Z are people born between 1997 and 2012. Then you've got millennials born between 1981 and 1996. Then you've got the Gen X folks that are born between 1965 and 1980. Then you've got baby boomers born between 1946 and 1964. And while the surveys reveal, this is interesting, that it's that young generation right now, Gen Z, that suffers anxiety on a level that can genuinely be described as unprecedented, the truth is there is a rise in anxiety in our country, in our culture today, in every single generation, from Gen Z all the way up to baby boomers like me. Now, you and I know that there's no question COVID-19 had a huge effect on this rise in anxiety. But beyond COVID, there is just a laundry list of different reasons for the anxious age that we're living in. There's what some people see as the erosion as of our social fabric, our economic and political systems, and in some cases, for some people, our natural environments. There are what seems to be large-scale threats to our health, to our safety, to our economic well-being, our security. There's a growing lack of trust, not just in other people, but oftentimes in leaders and in authorities. And you add to that the reality that every passing day, there is an increase in the amount of information propagated through electric media. And oftentimes it is so biased, it's hard to know what to believe. And you can go on and on and on. The bottom line is we live in an age of great, great anxiety. And that's just this look at it in a broad From a broad perspective. You can add to that all of the personal stories. For example, all the personal stories I could share with you about my conversations with people who are just immobilized in their life by different levels of anxiety. And yet, here's the thing. In the midst of all of this, as people of faith, as followers of Jesus, we simply can't ignore what could only be described as the simple and direct teaching of Jesus when it comes to the reality of anxiety. And that brings us to Matthew chapter 6. And so if you've got your Bibles open there and you're able today, I'm going to invite you to stand and we're going to read the scripture together. Matthew chapter 6, and our text is verse 25 down through verse 34. One of the most significant teachings in all the Bible related to this issue of worry and anxiety. In fact, the chapter heading in my Bible, and I'm sure it's similar to yours, right above verse 25, simply says, "Do not worry." So Jesus says, this is a part of the Sermon on the Mount, "Therefore I tell you, do not worry about your life, what you will eat or drink, or about your body, what you will wear. Is not life more important than food, and the body more important than clothes? Look at the birds of the air. They do not sow or reap or store away in barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not much more valuable than they? Who of you, by worrying, can add a single hour to his life? And why do you worry about clothes? See how the lilies of the field grow? They do not labor or spin. Yet I tell you that not even Solomon in all his splendor was dressed like one of these. If that is how God clothes the grass of the field, which is here today and tomorrow is thrown into the fire, will he not much more clothe you, O you of little faith? So do not worry, saying, what shall we eat, or what shall we drink, or what shall we wear? For the pagans run after all these things, and your heavenly Father knows that you need them. But seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. Therefore, do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about itself. Each day has enough trouble of its own. All right, there it is. You can be seated. We always ask that God would bless the reading and the hearing of his word. This past week, and I'm going to tell you in advance, this is not like the normal messages I preach, because I have absolutely no outline for this message. We're going to tackle this issue of worry and anxiety from Jesus's words here in Matthew chapter 6, verses 25 through 34, but not even verse by verse or line by line, more in an overview. And so if you are someone who likes to take notes, it might be a little bit more challenging for you this weekend, but there will be some good truths for you to write down. This past week, I read the story of an old Scottish professor and preacher named James Stewart, who once made this really helpful distinction between what he called the foreground and the background of life. He used the example or the metaphor of a picture or a painting, and he said that just like a picture or a painting has both a foreground and a background, our lives have a foreground and a background as well. The foreground are the things that are right in front of us, the things that we can easily focus on, the things that we feel like are right on top of us. They are the things, to make it really simple, that are quickly and easily seen. The background, in contrast to that, are the sometimes invisible, unseen realities of our lives that are also present, but not always clearly visible. You ever been online, or you ever in your personal life looked at a picture and you thought, wow, that's a good picture, until you saw what was in the background? For example, I mean, that little boy, if I was his dad, I would take that stick and I would do something with it. Or here's another example. You know, what a nice looking young couple. I don't know what's going on with the dog in the background. The foreground and the background. How about another one? Okay. What a sweet picture. Looks like he's in timeout to me. I don't know. How about another example? I love this one. Everybody say, aw. And then this hippo is just taking it in. Got a front row seat. Just feel bad for Elmo, don't you? I mean, in Times Square, I mean, nobody's giving any love to Elmo. And then I like this one. Oh, so scary. Oh my gosh, what's going on with this baby? So you see what I'm talking about. There's a foreground and a background in every picture. Sometimes you don't notice the background right away, even though it's always there. And it's that way in life, too. There's a foreground and a background in life, and we need to remember that. And here's the other thing that we need to remember. And if you like to write things down, then you need to write this down somewhere. These two things, the foreground and the background, are not divided. Another way to say it would be like this. They are never, ever separate. They are present at all times. They are both a part of our lives. Even though one is seen, or at least more clearly seen, and one is sometimes unseen. Now, if you think about this in terms of, excuse me, people of faith or followers of Jesus and our lives, then you have to recognize the same truth. There is a foreground and a background in our lives as we live as followers of Jesus, as we live faithful lives serving God. In spiritual terms, we might replace the words foreground and background with the words secular and sacred. So just like there's a foreground and a background to every picture, in our lives, there is a foreground and a background in everything that happens, or in other words, we might call it, there is what's secular and there is what's sacred. The secular is like the foreground, it's right in front of us, it's the things we can easily focus on, things that feel like they're right on top of us, they are the everyday experiences of life. The sacred or the background are those immutable truths of our faith that, like the background of a picture or painting, are not always clearly seen. But even though they're not always clearly seen, they're always there, and they should be the anchors of our lives no matter what we face in life. And so we need to understand as believers that there should never be any kind of separation or any kind of divide between what we're calling the foreground and background of life or the secular and sacred reality of our life. Now, having said that, let's think about that in terms of this passage of Scripture that we're studying today. This passage we just read, Matthew chapter 6, verses 25 through 34. It's not difficult to look at these words and recognize the truth that Jesus' words contain both a foreground and a background. His words contain both a secular emphasis and a sacred emphasis. For example, in Matthew chapter 6 and verse 25, Jesus said, "Therefore, I tell you, do not worry about your life." Now, if you look at that in the original language of the New Testament, the Greek word that Jesus uses for life is the Greek word sukha. And it has a broad range of meanings in that it can include the inner part of our life, like the mind and the heart and the emotions and the will. But there's another aspect of the word that you look at and understand that it just is a reference to the everyday reality of life or the everyday reality of human experience. And in this context, in Matthew 6:25, when Jesus says, "Therefore, I tell you, do not worry about your life, your suke," he's just talking about the everyday experiences and the everyday reality of life. Why do I say that? I say that because Jesus goes on to say, therefore I tell you, do not worry about your life. Then he says, what you will eat or drink, or about your body, what you will wear. So he's not talking about big picture dramatic issues. He's just talking about the everyday realities of life. Don't worry about your life and the everyday realities of life. For example, what you're going to eat, what you're going to drink, or what you're going to wear. But what I want you to see is he doesn't just make that as a blanket statement. He doesn't just say, do not worry about your life. He goes on to give some context to that statement. Because you go down to chapter 6, verse 26, and Jesus uses an example. He says, look at the birds of the air. They do not sow or reap or store away in barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. And then he says, are you not much more valuable than they? And then if you skip down to verses 28 through 30, he continues giving context to his words. Therefore, do not worry about your life, your sukkah, your everyday life. Because he says, and why do you worry about clothes? See how the lilies of the field grow? They do not labor or spin, yet I tell you that not even Solomon in all his splendor was dressed like one of these. If that is how God clothes the grass of the field, which is here today and tomorrow is thrown into the fire, will he not much more clothe you, O you of little faith? Do you see what Jesus is doing? He's recognizing the foreground of life or the secular reality of life. He's recognizing the truth that there are literal, physical things in all of our daily lives that can be easy to worry about, that can be easy to make us anxious. Even lists a few of them: what you'll eat, what you'll drink, what you'll wear. It's not an exhaustive list, but it doesn't have to be, because Jesus is just trying to make a point. He's just using those things as an example to make a point. There are things in life, there are concerns, everyone say concerns, concerns in life that we can view as easy to worry about. And a lot of people, this is their experience. That's the foreground of life. That's the secular reality of life. But he's also reminding us that there's never a foreground without a background. And for people of faith, there's never a secular without a sacred. And he's teaching us that even though there are things in life that are easy to worry about, what we need to remember, that's the foreground, that's the secular. What we need to remember is that there's a background, there's a sacred aspect of life, and that sacred aspect of life is that God can be trusted with all the concerns of our lives. And remember, those two things can never be divided. Foreground and background, never divided. Secular and sacred, never divided. And the background in this passage, the sacred in this passage, is the truth that if our Heavenly Father is committed to taking care of the birds of the air in a way that they don't even have to give any thought to life or any thought to the future, and if he's so committed to taking care of the lilies of the field that all they have to do is simply clothe the grass in splendor, how much more will he take care of you and me? If he'll take care of the foreground realities of the birds of the air and the grass of the field, how much more will he take care of the foreground reality of your life and mine? That's the point. So at the risk of being redundant, And honestly, I don't care about being redundant today, because there's a central point that needs to be driven home in all of our lives, in all of our hearts, over and over and over again until it really sinks in. We can't miss the truth that in one of the most significant passages in the Bible on the subject of worry and anxiety, Jesus is identifying for all of us, this is applicable for all of us, that in our lives there's a foreground and a background. In our lives there is the secular reality of life and there's the sacred reality of life. And we need to remember both. We need to understand and remember both, because that will help us obey Jesus' command, so do not worry about your life. But let me try to really emphasize it for you. I'm going to put three different verses on the screen, all from our text today. First of all, I'm going to put Matthew 6:25. Jesus says, therefore, everyone say therefore. Therefore, I tell you, do not worry about your life, what you will eat or drink, or about your body, what you will wear. Is not life more important than food, and the body more important than clothes? Now Matthew 6:31. So do not worry, saying, what shall we eat, or what shall we drink, or what shall we wear? Now Matthew 6:34. Therefore, one more time, everyone say therefore. Therefore, do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about itself. Each day has enough trouble of its own. Now, Matthew 6:25, Matthew 6:31, Matthew 6:34 in my NIV Bible are all about this command, this instruction from Jesus not to worry. In verse 25 and verse 34, both verses begin with the word therefore. Now, verse 31 in my NIV Bible just begins like this: so do not worry. But if you look at that verse in the original language of the New Testament, you could see that it could easily also begin with the word therefore. And in fact, there are some translations, because I looked in a lot of different translations this last week, where verse 31, just like verse 25 and 34 in my NIV Bible, actually does begin with the word therefore. Maybe some of you are even reading a translation that does that right now. Here's the point I want to make. It's significant. The reason why we need to look at each of those three verses separately is it's significant to recognize that Jesus in the Sermon on the Mount doesn't just say, I tell you, do not worry about your life. And he doesn't just say, do not worry. And he doesn't just say, do not worry about tomorrow. He begins each instruction with the thought, or with the word, therefore. Therefore, I tell you not to worry about your life. Therefore, do not worry. Therefore, do not worry about tomorrow. And friends, here's what that means on the most practical level. It means that as you go through life, if you're a Christian, if you're a person of faith, if you're a follower of Jesus, as you go through life, you can make sure the foreground and the background, or the secular and the sacred reality of your life, are always present when you're tempted to worry, by simply asking yourself, whenever worry or anxiety begins to overtake you, this question: what's my therefore? In fact, I want us to all say that together. Ask that question out loud together. Let me hear your voices. Here we go. What's my therefore? If Jesus was just saying, do not worry about your life, or do not worry, or do not worry about tomorrow, that instruction or that command would not just be difficult, it would be irrational. In one sense, because life is full of concerns that can easily turn into worries. But Jesus is not doing that. He's adding the word therefore. And here's what that means. It means that this is a rational instruction. This is a rational command. It means that the peace Jesus wants to experience, peace is the opposite of anxiety, is a rational peace, because Jesus doesn't just give us a command, he gives us a therefore. which means he gives us a reason behind the command, a rational reason behind the command. He gives us a reason not to worry. So let me ask you a question this morning, especially if you're here in person or you're joining us online, and we're so glad to have all you folks joining us online. Let me ask you this question. When worry and anxiety begins to overtake your life, if you're someone who really struggles with that, what's your therefore? How you answer that question, or if you can answer that question, is going to go a long way to helping you overcome the reality of anxiety and worry. How about this as an answer to the question that comes straight from our text? Matthew chapter 6, verse 25 through 34. My therefore, when worry and anxiety start to attack my life, my therefore is I have a loving heavenly Father who cares about the needs of the birds of the air and the lilies of the field. And if he cares about their needs, how much more does he care about mine? How about that as an answer to your what's my therefore? That's really what Jesus is trying to tell us in this part of the Sermon on the Mount. But you know what, friends? If you're a student of the Bible, you know that it's so much more than that. How about this? Somebody said, what's your therefore? If I ask myself, what's my therefore? How about this? I have a loving heavenly Father who cares about me so much that he came into the world in the person of his son Jesus to show me who he is and what he is like. I don't have to wonder about who God is. I don't have to wonder or be confused about what God is like, because Jesus was God in human flesh. And the Bible makes it clear that one of the reasons why he came into the world, not the ultimate reason, but one of the reasons why he came into the world was to literally show people like you and me what God is like. Amen. And seeing the reality of who God is in this person of Jesus, as I read my Bible, in particular the Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, over and over again, takes away my worry. It takes away my anxiety, because it gives flesh and blood. It gives context to this love and this care and this concern of a heavenly Father. And we could take that a step further, and we could find specific examples that would bless or minister to our hearts. Here's one of them that I would use to do that. I would turn my Bible to Matthew chapter 11, verses 28 through 30. We'll put these words up on the screen. In fact, I want you to read them with me. Let me hear your voices. Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. I love that passage of scripture. In fact, I've said many times, that's my favorite picture of Jesus in the Gospels. And when I mean by picture of Jesus, if I read the words of Jesus and I get a picture in my mind about what that looks like, this is my favorite. Because I get this picture in my mind of Jesus, who is filled with love and compassion and concern, and I see that, you can see that in his face, and I get this picture of him with his arms outstretched to needy, hurting, broken, anxious people like you and me, and he says these words, come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you what? Rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find, here it is again, rest for your souls, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light. And that's this picture of God, my loving heavenly Father, your loving heavenly Father that we see painted in the words of Jesus. But let's take it even a step further. I can look at that passage and I can see three simple truths about Jesus, all of which counter the anxiety and the worry that threatens my life. The first thing I see is that if you have burdens, Jesus is calling you. How can you miss that truth? He says, come to me, all you who are weary and burdened. And if you're someone who struggles with or suffers from anxiety or worry in your life and the cares of life, you know that certainly qualifies as or can be characterized as a burden. And you know that if you struggle with anxiety or worry, you carry that kind of a burden around with you, that it absolutely wears you out, makes you exhausted. The second thing I see here, the simple truth is, if you have burdens, Jesus has something to offer you. We've already identified that. Jesus says, come to me, all you are weary and burdened, and I will give you, say it again with me, rest. Rest. And he even repeats that a second time in the latter part of the passage. So Jesus, who is God, who is our loving Heavenly Father, offers us rest. And don't you find, if you're someone who struggles with worry and anxiety, don't you find that when your life is overwhelmed by those things, what you need almost more than anything else is just a break? That what you need more than anything else is just some rest, some quiet time away from all of that chaos that worry and anxiety brings? And then the third simple truth that I see in those words that give me this incredible picture of God, our loving Heavenly Father. If you have burdens, you can give them to Jesus. Jesus says, this is an interesting part of the passage. In the end, he says, take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest, here he says it again, for your souls. Well, when Jesus says, take my yoke upon you and learn from me, he's using a real life example that his listeners would have been familiar with from first century farming. Whenever a young ox needed to be trained to work on the farm, then a farmer would attach that young ox to the yoke of an older ox. Whatever the older ox was doing, whether he was helping the farmer plow the field or he was turning a stone that was grinding grain or whatever it might be, he would attach the younger ox to the older ox. And so when the older ox would do the work, again, of plowing the field or turning the stone to grind the grain, the younger ox would be following in the footsteps of the older ox. The older ox would be carrying all of the burden. The younger ox wouldn't feel any of the burden of what was happening, but he was walking behind, learning to walk in those same steps. And so what Jesus is saying here, literally, is that when you come to me, when you walk with me, I'll pull the load so you don't have to. What a great promise that is. That's what's behind, take my yoke upon you and learn from me. Now, I can't speak for you, but putting all of that together, that sounds like a pretty strong answer to the question, what's my therefore? When worry and anxiety begins to attack my heart and my mind and overwhelm my life, that's a pretty strong answer to the question, what's my therefore? I know what's in the foreground. I know the secular reality of my life, the concerns that are weighing me down and causing me to be anxious. But what's in the background? What's the sacred part of my life that's sustaining me and helping me to overcome in the midst of all of this? So let's just say it. Let's just ask the question together again out loud. I want to hear your voices. What's my therefore? Say it with me. What's my therefore? Because Jesus doesn't, listen to me, he doesn't just say, don't worry. He doesn't just say, don't worry about your life. He doesn't just say, don't worry about tomorrow. He says, therefore. And we have to hang on to that. Let's take it a step further. I want everybody listening to me online, I want you to think of a time in your life when you were overwhelmed with anxiety because of some reality of life. Maybe it was just an everyday reality of life, or maybe it was an unusual reality of life, but just think about a time in your life when you were absolutely overwhelmed with anxiety because of something that was happening in your life. Just get that in your mind. Now, if you have that in your mind, let me ask you this. Can you remember specific ways that God, your loving Heavenly Father, showed up and showed himself to be loving and showed himself to be faithful and showed himself to be trustworthy, to be present in the midst of that anxiety? This last week on Thursday, I left my house in the morning and I drove to St. Francis Hospital over on Emerson to the heart hospital there to visit a man from our church who had open heart surgery, and he had been in the hospital for 7 or 8 days. And every time I drive, you know, there's only one really real route that I drive from my house to St. Francis Hospital. And every time I drive that route, I vividly remember all the time that I spent at the St. Francis Cancer Treatment Center back in 2012. And my wife, Sandy, would drive me to St. Francis Cancer Treatment Center every day, Monday through Friday, for 8 weeks. Every day. There wasn't anything in the calendar like a holiday that fell that made us to miss a single day. Every single day. Monday through Friday. One day a week, I would go and have chemotherapy, and it would last for about 2 hours, just once a week. But every day, 5 days each week, Monday through Friday, I would also go and have a radiation treatment that would last about 10 minutes. And that was my whole week, right there. 2 hours of chemotherapy, and 5 radiation treatments that only lasted about 10 minutes. And I had all of this free time on my hand, and I was weak and unable to do much of anything except lay in bed. And how many of you know you can only watch so much daytime TV? And so I'm telling you that because I'm telling you that there would be moments and there would be times in those 40 days when I would feel overwhelmed by anxiety. And all these questions would run through my mind. What if the treatment doesn't work? I mean, the doctor told me ahead of time, told Sandy and I, what you have is treatable and curable, but there's no guarantee. No two people respond the same way to the treatment. So it'd be, what if the treatment doesn't work? What if my wife Sandy becomes a widow at a young age? What if I'm not around for my children to give them guidance and help? What if I'm not around for my grandchildren? At the time, we only had one grandchild, and that was Grace, and she was just a baby. What if I'm not around to meet my future grandchildren? I look back on it today and I would say, what if I never met my grandson Jack or my grandson? Wyatt. And on and on and on. My life would be overwhelmed at times by anxiety. And so what I would do ultimately, at some point, is I would grab my Bible, this very Bible. I would read it. Sometimes I would just cling to it to my chest. But one of the places I would always go is to Psalm 20. And I would read Psalm 20 in verse 1 that says, may the Lord answer you when you are in distress. And this became like hold on passages for me. And so I would read that. I would hold on to the truth that I was not alone in my suffering, that my loving Heavenly Father was with me. And it was something that he didn't know about. He knew all about every detail of it. And Psalm 20 and verse 4 says, may he give you the desires of your heart and make all your plans succeed. And I would hang on to the truth that I was going to be healed, that this treatment was going to be effective, that what I had was treatable and curable, and that there was going to be an end of this for me one day. And Psalm 20 and verse 5 says, we will shout for joy when you are victorious, and we'll lift up our banner in the name of our God. May the Lord God grant all your requests. And I would hang on to this picture in my mind of what it would look back like when I was on the other side of all of this, and I was back standing right here where I am right now, looking at people like you with my Bible open, sharing the wonderful truth of God's word. And using Psalm 20 and other passages we don't have time to talk about gave me, in times of great anxiety, great fellowship with God, my loving Heavenly Father, the same loving Heavenly Father Jesus talked about in Matthew 6, verses 25 through 34 that we read about just a few minutes ago. And it brought me great suffering with him during my suffering, and it reinforced to me the faithfulness of God. And you know what it became for me? It became, what is my therefore? To overcome this anxiety and this worry. What's your therefore? Friend, how long have you walked with Jesus? How long have you been a follower of Christ? How long have you belonged in the family of your loving Heavenly Father? Surely you have an answer to that question, right? What's my therefore? So that when worry and anxiety attack your life, you're not left all feeling all alone in the dark. What's your therefore? Jesus doesn't ask us, he doesn't give us an irrational command. Do not worry. Hey, Do not worry. He says, therefore, do not worry. There's a reason why we don't have to worry. What's your therefore? You might not recognize the name Thomas Obadiah Chisholm. We'll close with this. The band can get ready to come. He was born in the mid-1800s near Franklin, Kentucky, and from a very early age, he dealt with debilitating health concerns that affected not just every part of his life, but almost everything that he did, and caused him to fail at almost everything that he did except one thing that he was very good at. And that one thing he was very good at was writing poems. And so that's what he spent a great deal of his time doing. And even though you might not recognize his name, I know you would recognize one of his most famous poems because it was put to music and it's become a beloved hymn that people cling to in times of great anxiety and worry. It's become a "What's My Therefore?" for a lot of people. And it goes like this. I want you to sing it with me. Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest not, thy compassions, they fail not. As thou hast been, thou forever wilt be. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Somebody say amen to that. What's your therefore? That's the question we have to answer when it comes to worry and anxiety. Father in heaven, we love you so much and we're so grateful for Jesus' words in Matthew chapter 6 that teach us how to cope with worry and anxiety when it threatens our lives. And my simple prayer today is that there's not a single person here who walks in faith, who walks in faith in Jesus, with faith in Jesus, that can't answer that question, what's my therefore? And that will become more than just an anecdotal part of a sermon, one of a thousand sermons that they've heard over the years, but that will become an anchor for their life. And I pray that in Jesus' name, amen.